You can choose to go through hard times, or you can choose to what? Good. Oh, so good when you guys do that. I love it. Because I know that means that you remembered it, right? And I know that means that you're going to hit hard times. You're going to be like, I'm going to choose to grow, not just go. Because everyone is going to go through hard times. Like, let me just predict the future for you, right? Let me just prophesy that, right? Hard times, going to happen. And if you aren't going through hard times, if you're like one of those people who you just feel like everything is always wonderful and everything's golden and everything you touch is just great, like, we don't like you. Because that's not true. You're just good at hiding it. You're just good at pretending. Authenticity is powerful. Authenticity is powerful because it frees you to be exactly who God needs you to be in the moment that you're in. And it also frees up others to realize that they are not alone in their struggle and in their frustration. One of my least favorite things, though, when you're going through hard times is the things that Christians say to you, right? Like the stuff that Christians say. There's a better word for stuff, but I probably shouldn't say it at church, right? Christians say some dumb-ish. They do, right? You're going through something bad's happening to you. You just got a diagnosis that you have cancer or that your cousin has cancer, whatever, and people come up to you and they're like, you know what, my mom, she had that same diagnosis. Man, it was miserable right up until the day she died. But I'm praying for you. Like, shut up. What is that? Just keep your mouth shut. Like, you don't always have to say something. When you don't know what to say, say nothing at all, right? We say weird stuff. And then we take little parts and pieces of scripture and we turn them into little platitudes, little statements, little bumper stickers, little tweetables, right? Like, God's never going to put you through something that you can't handle. I don't know where that is in the Bible, but it sounds like it's in the Bible. But it's not in the Bible. There are plenty of circumstances where the people of God were put through things that were bigger and harder than they were able to bear. Scripture does tell us that there is no temptation that's unique to one mankind, one person, that man, humanity, faces all the same temptations, and that when you're under the weight of that temptation, that God will provide you a way of escape. It says that, and so maybe that's where they get it. Like, that because God's going to give you a way of escape, that means that you've got this, right? Or when you've lost someone that you love and they say, well, God just wanted them more than you did. You hear that out loud, right? When it's said out loud and you're not in the middle of trying to comfort somebody. No, you mean to tell me that God wanted my baby more than I did? Now me and God need to fight because that's not cool. Christians say some weird stuff. Weird stuff all the time. And it's not coming from a place of evil. It's not coming from a place of trying to do bad or malicious. It's just coming from a place of we don't know what to say. And so we try to drop fake knowledge, fake wisdom because it's been said to us. And there's this thing that just happens. It happens all over in church. We call it Christianese. It's our own little language that we speak. I want you to pay attention the next time that you're praying or the next time someone's praying. Don't do it in a shameful way to each other, but start to hold each other accountable with this privately if you have enough of a relationship. So like Donnie and I, we have a good relationship. If Donnie was to pray, I could say to Donnie, Donnie, you said Lord God, Father God, dear God, Jesus God, like 22 times in the prayer that lasted 2 minutes, right? We don't talk to anybody else like that, right? I wouldn't be like, hey, Donnie, I was just wondering, Donnie, if tomorrow, Donnie, you could come by, Donnie, Master Donnie, Sir Donnie, Concrete Master of the World, Donnie, and help me lay out this concrete in my front yard, Donnie, because I don't know, Donnie, if I have the ability to do it, Donnie. Donnie, in your name, Donnie, 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 right? But somebody ahead of us modeled it for us. And so then we think that's what spiritual sounds like. I'm guilty. I'll do it too. You're probably, if I pray today, which I will pray at some point out loud for you, you're going to count them, right? It gets ingrained in us. And so it's the same thing. People say things, they do things, they go through things, and they have all of these It's like baggage and language and culture. And if you're not careful, culture can shape a church. And you have to shape the culture of our church. That's why we say all the time, we don't go to church, we... It's not just something we say, it's something we need to actually shape. That we need to steward our own discipleship. That it's up to you and I to make sure that we're living out what we're learning. And if we believe that the future matters, then we need to live like today matters. But we also need to be paying attention to the choices we make today because they impact the future. People say to me things like this all the time. I can't believe you're going through blank, whatever horrific, terrible, awful stuff that's been thrown at my family that week. I can't believe you're going through this, or I can't believe you're going through this again. And then they say phrases like, you know, well, at least God chose someone strong enough to carry it. And I'm like, hey, you know, God, you could pick somebody else. You could pick someone weaker. You could pick someone like, I don't even care who you pick. Just pick somebody else. I'm good. My inclusion needs have been met. So I want to give you a better phrase than that when for you to use on yourself, not for you to use on other people. Are you ready for it? It's sort of like you can go through it or you can grow through it. That's for you. Right? That's not for you to just say to everyone, like when someone's like, oh man, I'm really getting beat up this week. Well, you can go through it or you can grow through it. That's like saying, suck it up, buttercup. Right? It's good for you to tell yourself when you're looking in the mirror. It's not so good to tell somebody who's right in the middle of it, right? When you find yourself in a season of darkness, when you find yourself feeling like you're lost, you could call it a desert experience, you could call it a wilderness experience, you could feel like you're far away from God, you could feel like, I don't know why, there's lots of words to describe it. Well, you could feel like there's darkness, like it doesn't make sense. Why does this keep happening? I'm in the valley, right? The psalmist said it like this, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, that the shadow of death is on me, that I feel nothing but pain and sorrow and fear and shame, and it's all the time, and it's depressive, and it's hard, right? And when you're in that darkness, this is something that I tell myself on a regular basis. While I'm here, I'm going to allow my eyes to adjust to the darkness. This is important. You know what I'm talking about when I say eyes adjust to the darkness, right? If you've been in the darkness for a while, you can almost see in the dark. You've all been there before, yes? Yeah? Like if you're out camping, right? And it's dark, and then you go out of your tent and it's dark and it's been dark, you can like see where you are. In your house, you know how to get around in the darkness in the middle of the night because the lights have been off for a few hours, and now you get up to go to the bathroom and you know the path and your eyes adjust. But like if it's bright and then all of a sudden someone turns off the lights, what happens? You're blind. You can't see anything. And you might have some memory of where things are and hope that no one moved anything. But when your eyes adjust to the darkness, it gives you clarity in the darkness. This is important. Because there are people who have been trapped in the darkness for decades. And friends, you are just a visitor in that dark valley. You're just passing through. We just sang it. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I'm a child of God. They split the seas so I could walk right through it. He's referencing the children of Israel as they were leaving Egypt, and that their slave masters were coming back after them. And they were faced with two choices: jump into an ocean and die, or be murdered, or taken captive again. And God opened up the ocean, and they walked across on dry land, and their pursuers drowned under the weight of that water as they escaped. The same is true with God pulling you from your darkness, your fear, your despair. The reason that you are in it is because life is full of hard times. Sin has entered the world. Not because God's making you go through it. Did you hear that? God didn't cause this to you. God doesn't choose for you to go through this. God doesn't want you to go through this. It isn't him testing you. It isn't him pushing you into a corner to see how much you love him. This is not the God that we serve. However, because darkness comes on all of us, why not let your eyes adjust to the darkness? So that you can grab someone by the hand or the wrist or the back of the neck and lead them out. Some people become so comfortable in their darkness that they think that that's all that there is. Sometimes those people need to be drugged out of the darkness. And sometimes we're in such a hurry to feel good and to be positive and have everything be wonderful, rainbows and puppy dogs, right? That we want to get out of the darkness so fast that we miss our opportunity to adjust to the moment, to see those that God's entrusted to us. Again, it's not that he puts you in that situation, but if you're there, you might as well. You might as well. You might as well make the most of that situation to make the biggest difference in the lives of the people that are there, that are stuck there, that have been going through it for quite some time. Now again, I'm not talking about you not having the right to grieve or you not having the right to feel your fear. I'm not talking about you not, you know, like pretending like it's all perfect and wonderful and I'm here because I'm a soldier of God and we're just going to march right through hell and back. No, I'm saying pause for a moment and appreciate. I know that sounds crazy, right? Appreciate the darkness. Because there's some people that have been there a long time that need you to pull them out. And if they're going to have a future, they're going to need you. This truth applies to everything that we've been talking about over the course of this last couple of years. I wish that I could say, you know, that we were only going to be dealing with these kind of topics for 14 days, but here we are coming up on 2 years of this conversation, aren't we? People feel stuck. People forced into a corner. People not happy with their decision, people losing people that they love, people losing their jobs, people losing their sense of normalcy, people feeling like nothing is ever going to be the same again. And the only thing I know to do when I'm in those dark times is to pause, let my eyes adjust, and then go back to the scripture and leverage it for all that it's worth to help the people that are around me. Last week, we talked about the reality that financial hardship is going to be a reality this year. And some of you are like, Pastor, why do you speak in, why don't you like speak that into existence? What? No, I'm just saying, like, look at the world around us. Look at the price of gas. Look at the price of milk. Look at the price of everything. Yeah, but they're raising wages. Oh, yeah, but that's just going to make milk get more expensive. It's going to be expensive. And so for you to be like a holistic follower of Jesus, you have to think about more than just Sunday morning. You have to think about everything. It's not just your 10%, but it's your 90% that God cares about as well. And so we're talking about this idea of what generosity looks like. But I want to talk about the future this morning, and I want to talk about a church. Grab your Bibles. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 8. In this message, we read about the extraordinary generosity of a group of churches in the Macedonian region. And we learn, as Paul writes to the churches, of what's happening and what's going on, all the churches that are together. Now, you know that this idea of churches that are all over the place but that collaborate with each other is a biblical concept, right? And now, churches in the New Testament, were some were really small and some were medium-sized and some were rather big, but they all worked together as they followed Christ and they helped each other and they shared with each other. And if you look at this passage, and Paul, he's talking to the people at Corinth, and listen to what he says to them. He says, "We want you to know, brothers, about the grace of God that has been given among the churches of Macedonia. For in a severe test of affliction, their abundance of joy and their extreme poverty have overflowed in the wealth of generosity on their part. He says, even though they're feeling like they're in the darkest of places and spaces, even though they're actually going through some seriously hard times right now, even though they're feeling oppression and pain and suffering as a people, they heard that you needed help. They heard that the churches in Jerusalem needed help. They heard that the body needed help. And so they said, well, we might as well grow through it. And they said, well, let's have some joy while we're doing this. For they gave according to their means, as I can testify, and beyond their means, of their own accord, begging us earnestly for the favor of taking part in the relief of the saints. And this, not as we expected, but they gave themselves first to the Lord and then by the will of God to us. Father in heaven, I ask right now that you would take these next few moments of time and let us learn how to live generously in the midst of darkness with our time, our talent, our treasure, and our testimony. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, if you're just joining us this week and you weren't here last week, I'm going to give you just a really brief catch up. When we talk about generosity at Hope City Church, we're not necessarily talking about money. However, money is a part of generosity, and it will be a part of a conversation that we're having today. It isn't what generosity means. Generosity is a heart thing and has way more to do with your heart than it has to do with your wallet. The condition of your heart is what God cares about. He doesn't really need what's in your wallet. Did you hear that? It's your heart that he needs. The problem is that for most of us, what's in our wallet controls our heart. The funny thing is, if you look at our money, it even says right on it, right, in God we trust. Even your dollars tell you, I cannot be trusted. And yet we put most of our faith in our money. And so when we talk about generosity, what we're really talking about is an attitude or a lifestyle of open-handed living. And I just want to give you that in case you came today, in case today was your first time. Like, oh, great, I came to church and they're talking about money. I knew this was going to be that kind of church, right? No, no. What we're talking about is an attitude by which we share what we have with others. Our time, our talents, yes, our treasure, but most importantly, our testimony, the story of what God's doing in your life. Not what he did, that's important, but what he's continuing to do in and through you. That these are the powerful moments, an open-handed living, a lifestyle of generosity, when you find yourself in dark places and spaces, are the way that you grab a hold of the attention of those who are stuck in that darkness and lead them to his marvelous light, and lead them to who Jesus is. Generosity captures the heart and the mind of people when you're living it out. When you give someone time, I'm going to tell you something right now. When you see somebody on the street that's living on the street, maybe they're flying a cardboard sign, or you walk in and they're asking for a quarter as you walk by, right? Do you know what they really want more than the quarter? Truthfully, they want you to see them. Yes, they want the quarter that they're asking for, right? And I love clever signage. I don't know how you guys feel about this. I saw a guy the other day. He said, my spaceship broke down, need money for parts. I'm like, I'm giving that dude money. A couple of years ago, I saw a guy, he had a sign, he was standing on the entrance to the freeway where there's a big long line of cars waiting, and he said, I bet you can't hit me with a quarter. It's a good sign right there, right? But what they really want is to be seen, right? And what we really do most of the time is, like, look away, head down. Because we feel shame that we don't want to give them money, or we don't have money to share, and we live in a mindset of scarcity instead of abundance. If I give them a dollar, if I buy them a hamburger, if I help them, what if they don't do good things with it? There's a whole mentality that goes with that, right? And so we see that and we move past. Or we see somebody who's suffering or going through something and we don't know what to say, so we say nothing at all. You know, you don't actually have to say anything. Sometimes all you have to do is just give someone your time. One of the most powerful ways that you can be generous with someone is with your time, especially in the world we live in now, right? Just with your time. And that's why we say it time, talent, treasure, testimony, because it's so much more than just a little bit. So when we talk about this embracing a lifestyle of generosity, what we're talking about is this understanding, why should I be generous, or why we choose at Hope City Church to put generosity at the forefront. We have a few values that we hold higher than all of our other values. Now, these are lifestyle values. These aren't our core biblical values. We have core biblical values too. These are our lifestyle values. Our lifestyle values are authenticity, connectivity, serving, and generosity. That we feel like that sort of a lifestyle is a powerful way to express Christ to the world around us. That when you're authentic, we don't pretend, we try to be real all the time. This one, we want this to be a place where it's okay to not be okay. Amen? Right? That connectivity is important. Relationships matter. We don't want you to just come in and leave. This isn't a place for you to come and bring your little spiritual cup and then have me fill it up and then you sip on it all week long and be like, wasn't that good, Pastor? Right? No, this is a place where real relationships happen, and that what we do in here is practice for what we're gonna do out there. And so if you don't have real, authentic relationships, connectivity, you're gonna be doing life alone, and you weren't designed to do life alone. And that serving, both inside and outside of the church, are very powerful tools of letting people know what it means to be a follower of Jesus. It's the greatest way to show someone that you love them. And that generosity of our time, talent, treasure, testimony unlocks and frees people to see the good news of the gospel instead of making the gospel into bad news. And so when we talk about why should I live a generous life, well, God gave to us first. Look at what Paul says to the church at Corinth. He says, "Now, brothers and sisters, I want you to know about the grace that God has given." The Macedonian churches, who are going through a bunch of stuff, recognized something, that God's grace gives me the ability to be gracious, to be generous. In other words, he gave it all. For God so loved the world, right? You know this, yes? For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have eternal life. John 3:16. That he gave his everything so that you could have everything. He gave first. This is powerful because when God gives his all and he gives it first, and then what he asks in return from us is very little. In return from us is very little. I mean, he gives it all, but it really costs me very, very little. It's very minimal, the cost. In fact, if you look at it, Matthew 10, verse 8, "Freely you have received, freely give. You have been treated generously, so live generously." That is counterintuitive to the world we live in, isn't it? The world we live in right now, it's like, well, you gain something, so hoard it, save it, because you don't know what's going to happen this year. We talked about that last week, right? Again, there's no shame in this because we all pretty much did it, right? We all bought way too much toilet paper. Because, oh no, there's going to be no toilet paper. Do you know, like, there's places in the world where toilet paper just isn't a thing? Come on. You're like, Pastor, what are you saying? I'm just saying, like, what we consider to be suffering, other people consider to be normal. And so before you take your faith in God and you push it, right, into your cultural expression of life, you better make sure that you're like, oh man, we are suffering so much. Do you know how hard it is to be us right now? We don't have toilet paper. They don't have toilets. Just putting it in perspective, I don't know why it always comes back to poop, but it does. What I want you to understand is that God gave freely to you, and he asks for you in return to share what he gave you. And he promises you that it'll always be enough. And when you share what he gave you, when you understand that authenticity, connectivity, serving, and generosity are powerful things, you see life-changing things happen in your communities. Since Hope City Church launched a little over 2 years ago now, we have seen a significant amount of not only baptisms and salvations. In fact, since launch, this is what it's looked like. I want you guys to check this out. 203 salvations since launch and 57 baptisms. Do you know why this is happening? Because you're leveraging your time, talent, and treasure. And you're like, well, I'm not very good at it. I know, I understand that. But you're learning how to do it. And that's discipleship. I learned it today. I practice it tomorrow. I teach somebody else about it. We try it together. That's the deal, right? Stewarding our own discipleship. Being the church. Now, mind you, that all of this has happened in the middle of a global pandemic. You know that there are churches in America that haven't baptized 57 people in the last 57 years. Because those people go to church. You what? Come on. To say that we've seen 203 people make decisions for Christ, that's a powerful tool. You're like, well, Pastor, where are they all? Not everyone that comes to the knowledge of Christ in our community will stay in our community. They will go on to where God calls them. Some of them move away. Some of them find other churches, other places, other spaces. Some of them struggle. Some of them wrestle. Like, you get it, right? But we're going to keep sharing our time, talent, treasure, testimony. Why? Well, because he gave to us first. So how do I not give of my time, my talent, my treasure, my testimony, when I know that if I just give a little? Now, let me challenge you in this. You ready? This has been during global pandemic where we've barely even got together and we barely have served, right? We've talked about this, right? Authenticity. We've been really good with that this last 2 years, haven't we? Like, everybody's like, my life sucks. Me too. I'm scared. Me too. Should I wear a mask? Should I not wear a mask? Should I get the shot? Should I not get the shot? Should I come to church? Should I stay home? What do I do? I don't know what to do. I'm scared. I'm freaking out. How much toilet paper is enough toilet paper? I don't know. We should figure it out together, right? We're being authentic. And we've went through death and birth and distress and painful times and good times and bad times and hard times. We've done that really good. And connectivity, we've done okay, considering we couldn't even be together for half of it. Now, we start to drop off when it comes to serving. We haven't been serving like we once did. I want you to think about that for a second. Those of you, this isn't shame. This is just reality. Like, I think these numbers are great, but could you imagine what would happen if we all started serving again? Could you imagine what would happen if we really started leaning into our time, talent, treasure, testimony and saying, like, hey, I have an abundant life and I'm not going to run out. That God is going to continue to bless me every time I share. Because he gave first, and if I give it away, he'll give me more. This is the power of generous living. Now, I'm going to tell you something right now. The second reason that we choose to live generously is because, and again, joy comes from generosity. Now, sometimes people, this is the only reason that they give, and it's a starting place, and it's an okay place. But it's just one of the reasons. It's not the only reason that doing for others feels good. Listen to what Paul says. He says, they are being tested by many troubles and they are very poor, but they also are filled with abundant joy, which is overflowed in rich generosity. And it's a bit cyclic. Like when you have joy, it's easier to be generous. And when you are generous, it increases your joy, right? And something's got to give for you to get on that crazy cycle of joyous generosity. Well, I mean, I'm just not happy. And until I am happy, I'm not going to share what I have. Well, you're going to be unhappy. But you got to give, right? Most of you adults would rather see someone unwrap a Christmas present that you thoughtfully got for them than unwrap one yourself. Most of us. Some of us are younger, and some of us maybe not. It's okay. God's still working on my heart too, right? Some of us are still kids and we're like, I could care less about what you're unwrapping. I want what I want. And that's okay. But most of us, we really want to see our kids and our grandkids and our nieces and our nephews and the people that we love. We want to see the blessing that we can be in their life. And that brings us joy. Why would that be any different? He says that the church, even though they were going through darkness, even though they were going through hard times, they let their eyes adjust to the darkness enough that they were able to bring joy in the middle of the darkness to other people who were stuck in the darkness. It's a powerful tool when you think about it. I mean, I want you to think about this for a second, right? This year as a church, with regards to missions, the stuff that we do outside of the four walls of this church, we've seen God do crazy cool things. This year, we've been able to give clean water to multiple tribes in Bolivia. We've brought relief to multiple cities through our partnerships with Convoy of Hope. We've served over 100 families in our city with food for the holidays. This is just a small portion of what we've been able to do because of our generosity, because we don't go to church, we are the church. And we did it in a pandemic. You're like, Pastor, when are we going to get back to what we used to do before? I don't know. I don't know that we are. I don't know what the plan is for the future. I know God's got some dreams that he's putting in our hearts, and we're going to follow those dreams where he leads us. But we're not going to always look back at the past and go, let's recreate that. We're going to go, God, where are you at work? And let's join you where you're at. And even though things might be hard for you right now, don't miss out on your opportunity to increase your joy by sharing with others. Acts 20, 35 says it like this. You should remember the words of the Lord Jesus. It's more blessed to give than to receive. It's more blessed to give than to receive. This isn't just scriptural. This is science. Like, science tells us, Gallup news reports and research shows that there's a greater return for our well-being when we're buying material goods for others than when we're buying material goods for ourselves. That when you buy something for yourself, you're like, woo, yay, and then you forget about it soon and quick. But that when you purchase something for someone else, that feeling of joy actually lasts longer than when you just buy it for yourself. Again, buy stuff for yourself. There's nothing wrong with that. You want to go get new shoes, a new watch, a new coat, new hair, new nails, do it, right? You want to go get that new part for your truck that no one will ever see, but you'll know, right? Do it, right? It's okay. There's nothing wrong with that stuff. But the joy that you feel when you spoil yourself has diminished capacity than the joy you feel when you are generous with someone else. Neuroscientists have discovered the regions of the brain that are activated when we receive money, based off brain scans, glow even brighter when we are generous with our money. Isn't that interesting? And we probably don't even know that, right? Most of us don't even know that because we're always so concerned on getting that next fix. More, more, more. We'll do a lot of hard, nasty, dirty, shameful work, won't we? For a little bit of money. People, not you. You wouldn't do that. People. You know, some of you are like, yes, I would. Yeah. And we have. And yet, the center of your brain that lights up, right, that feels the reward sensation, that I did it and here's my reward, that it's more activated when you share than when you receive. So again, when Jesus says it's more blessed to give than receive, science wasn't even there to dictate that this was a reality, and yet the creator of science knew it already. This joy that we're talking about is this joy of generosity comes. Jesus models it for us, and we know that it's a reality because Jesus gave his all. We read it already in John 3:16, right? God so loved the world, he gave his one and only son, right? You can read it again in Hebrews 12:2. Fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, for the joy set before him endured the cross. What was the joy before Jesus that made him endure the work? What was the paycheck? Oh, come on. It was you. It was you no longer having to be stuck and in the darkness, but have someone grab you by the hand, by the wrist, or by the back of the neck and drag you into the light. You are his joy. So who for the joy set before him? The pioneer or the first, right? And the perfecter, the first and the finisher. He scorns the shame, and then he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. The joy that he felt was you. So when he loves us first, right, we have this model of what it looks like to, when we walk through the darkness, to be generous with those he's put next to us in those moments. Number three, if you're taking notes, reasons to be generous in your everyday life, because we're family. We don't go to church, we are the church. This is our family. Family is a choice that we make, not just what we're born into. And so when we choose to be a part of the family of God, we choose to be a part of something that's bigger than ourselves. 2 Corinthians 8:3-4, say it like this. For I testify, this is again Paul talking to the church at Corinth about the people in Macedonia. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able, even beyond their ability, entirely on their own. They urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service to the Lord's people. They said, well, we don't have a lot and things are hard for us, but can we want to be a part of this. We want to do something. This is our family, and yeah, it's our family all the way in Jerusalem that's suffering, but we want to be a part of it. Now, Paul's telling this to the church at Corinth because Corinth is affluent. And he goes, hey, I want you to know that your little brothers in Macedonia who are struggling, they found the secret of joy through generosity. And it's not what I want from you, it's what I want for you. I want you to have this same joy. One of the joys that I get to see each week as worship is about to kick off is we sing a couple of songs and then we pray and then the kids all start to single file out. We launched kids ministry after the pandemic in September. September, October, November, December, January. 5 months, right? We're averaging 30 kids each week in kids ministry on Sunday mornings. We've got 16 teachers that teach once a month. We have a goal of having 25. We'd love to have more teachers so that we can serve more kids because we've had up to 40. We had 41 one weekend, and our teachers in the two classrooms were like, yeah, we need a third classroom. And I'm like, well, we need a third classroom, but we need more teachers. Some of you are smiling because you've been in those big days, right? Do you know why this is so important? Do you know why this is so much joy and reason to celebrate? Because, again, right, I don't believe children are the future, and if you teach them well and let them lead the way, that they'll show you all the beauty that they possess inside. I don't believe that. Some of you are old enough that you know I'm quoting Whitney Houston, okay? Like, I believe that the kids are the church of today. They're not the church of tomorrow. And that they have every right to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ presented to them in a way that it's a language that they can understand and they can process, and that they will be greater disciplers and greater leveragers of their time, talent, treasure, and their testimony than you and I ever will. Do you know why? Because puppies are really good when you train them. But old dogs, takes a lot of energy to retrain them. And so when I say they're the church of tomorrow, for sure, but they're the church of right now. We don't send our kids to be babysat when we're in church or we're in home groups. This isn't childcare. This is, that's on Tuesday nights, that's their life group. On Sundays, that's their church. That's why we have them in here for worship. Some people have said to me literally, and again, if you're in the room, I love you, no shame, but you need to like be prayerful about this, ready? Pastor, why can't we just send all the kids? Why do we just take the babies during worship? Why do I have to have my kids with me during worship? Why do I have to have my kids with me during worship? I mean, I have them all week. I get it. The reason that you want to have them with you during worship is so you can see what happens. Like last week, there was a group of them and they were sitting all together over here and the worship songs were going. And the kids, right, immediately entered into worship. And you have to wait for your favorite song to come on. Come on, Pastor, tell them to sing Oceans. No. They don't care. They don't even know the words. And then after church, I was telling one of the parents that this happened, and one of the little boys, he goes, I almost have all the song words memorized. Yeah. He was so happy to just be worshiping. Like, this is our joy. That we're not, we believe in tomorrow so much that we invest today. This is a powerful moment for us, church, to understand this. When we say we are the church, that you're like, well, my kids are grown, or my kids don't know Jesus, or I messed up real bad and I wasn't serving Jesus like the way I should, and so my kids, they didn't come here. Listen, let me give you some good advice right now. If your kids are sideways, you're blaming yourself way more than you should. And if your kids are perfect, you're giving yourself way more credit than you should. Because kids, they're tiny human beings that do whatever they want to do when they want to do it. And all you can kind of do is go, whoa, 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 right? And sometimes they get by and they do their own thing, and that's life. And guess what? It's okay. But it's not too late for you to be a grandparent or a parent to a fatherless generation, to a motherless generation. It's not too late for you to be someone who leads them in the places and spaces that God's called them to be. And do you know how you do it? Through your time, talent, treasure, and your testimony. If you serve in kids' ministry and you tell your story, and when your story and God's story and their story collide, it makes this beautiful mess that requires no cleanup on your part. When you actually participate in a musical worship service and the kids see you, that's powerful. How do you think you learn to say Father God, Lord Jesus every time you pray 100 times? Somebody modeled it for you. What if you modeled joy in your generous nature in your everyday life for the kids that God's entrusted to you? What if you model for them what it looks like to worship? What if you model for them what it looks like to read your Bible? What if you modeled for them what it looks like to serve? What if you modeled for them what kind of life change could you see? I want to see that 30 number, honestly. Like, I want to see that number continue to climb. But to do that, we've got to have the infrastructure of leaders to do that. We've got to be generous with our time, our talent, our testimony, our treasure to make that happen. Why? Because, well, they're important. He goes on, Paul, in chapter 8, verse 3, he says, I testify that they gave as much as they were able, even beyond their ability. And so he says, when he talks about they were able and beyond their ability, he's talking about what we would, in modern day times, we would talk about differentiating between tithes and offerings. On your chair, you'll see that there is an envelope. We talk about this sometimes where he says tithes and offerings, and then you have the total, and then there's a line for future hope. Your tithe, for those of you who, maybe that's like a new phrase for you, is 10% of your gross income. The idea of that is that I give God my first and my best so that he can bless all of the rest. It rhymes, so you remember. First and best, bless the rest, right? God, that little bit that he gives, like he gives his all, and all he expects us to do is give a little, and then he lets us keep the 90. All of it's his anyways, because we are his. And so he says, return, I like to say it like this, return the tithe, because it's his anyway. I don't pay my tithes, I don't give my tithes, I return them because they're his anyway, right? And so this idea of when he's talking right now, he's giving a like very commonplace language to the differentiation that's happening. They didn't just give what was expected of them or what they were able to do in their normal, everyday Christian life. He, in this particular time especially, tithing would have been understood to be the bare minimum. I like to do it like this, right? Tithing is like not cheating on your spouse. Duh, right? Like, babe, you're so lucky that I don't cheat on you. Does that make sense? Like when we tithe, it's not like a trumpet shouldn't blast, right? It shouldn't be like, you're so generous, right? My husband loves me so much. My wife loves me so much. They don't mess around with anyone else. Well, yeah, that's like normal, right? And so when he says this in the phrase, right, even beyond their ability, he's saying they didn't just tithe, but even though they were poor and oppressed and they dug deep and they went all out. They did something amazing because they knew the family was in need. Leviticus 27:30 says, one-tenth of the produce of your land, whether it's grain from the fields or fruit, belongs to the Lord and must be set apart to him as holy. So the idea of tithing wasn't supposed to ever be optional. All the way back to the Old Testament, it was supposed to be, if you take the 10 and you invest it back into the kingdom of generosity, God's kingdom, that it will, yes, it will give you joy. Yes, it will build the kingdom. Yes, it will do life change. Yes, it will help the people that you've been entrusted to. All those things will happen. But it was supposed to be normalized. And we've somehow along the journey made it not normal. And we want to be patted on the back when we do what's normal. And that's not disrespect to anyone or make anybody feel bad. I'm just saying, like, this is the scripture, right? Malachi 3:10 says it like this. Bring the tithe into the storehouse. Put in my temple. If you do, says the Lord of heaven's armies, I will open the windows of heaven for you and I will pour out blessings so great that you won't have enough room to take it in. Try it. Put me to the test. Now, we talked about this last week, so if you weren't here last week, you need to go watch it and catch up. Tithe isn't just, because generosity isn't just finances. It's time, talent, treasure, testimony. And so he's saying, if you give of yourself for the kingdom, I will bless you beyond your wildest dreams. That doesn't mean you're not going to go through hard times. That doesn't mean that bad things aren't going to happen. That doesn't mean that you're not going to have to face the darkness. It means that in the middle of the darkness, you know where your joy comes from. Your joy comes from sharing your love and your energy and your service and your ability with the people that are there with you. And that gives you the ability to have the strength to climb out. Because if it was just you, you might as well curl up in a ball and die, right? The reason that you keep on keeping on is because there are people depending on you. And those people make your joy complete. That's how to be like Jesus. To find your joy in helping other people find their purpose. That's generosity. So when we talk about tithes and offerings over and above, we talk about this idea of abundant living. And when we get stuck in the cycle of scarcity, we can never move to the place of abundance. And that scarcity cycle has been something that the world has been living in for the last 2 years. I'm telling you, church, you and I need to break that cycle. Not just generationally, but right now, very significantly, we need to break that cycle for our own sanity and for our own success. Because we don't want to just survive in this next season, we want to thrive. Amen? You keep reading verse 4. He says, entirely on their own. Listen, this isn't a moment of arm twisting or back breaking. That God is a gentleman and he wants you to participate how you want to participate. If you don't want to tithe, you don't want to give offerings, you don't want to share your time, talent, treasure, your testimony, you do not have to. However, scripture says, what you sow, in other words, the seeds you plant, you will reap, you will harvest. So if you don't plant seeds, don't be sad when there is no harvest. If you aren't generous with the people he's entrusted to you, then who's going to be there for you when you need it? The church at Macedonia, they knew something. They knew what it was like to have life suck significantly. And so because of that, they said, oh, our brothers and sisters in Jerusalem are facing oppression. We understand that. We will come to their defense. Part of the time, a lot of the time, most of the time, that we get stuck when it comes to serving others, and we look at somebody who's down and out, and we go, why can't they just figure it out? Ask yourself this question. If you were in that situation, would it be that easy to figure out? Maybe. Possibly. Probably not. They saw it, and they participated because they wanted to do it. And they did it not because Paul told them to. They begged Paul. Paul even tried to wave them off. No, you guys, listen, there are way more churches like Corinth that have money that can do this. You guys can sit this one out. And they go, no, what? No, I'm not sitting this out. My brothers, my sisters are in need. I want to be a part of that need. Number four, if you're taking notes, the reason that we live a generous life at Hope City Church is because we believe in the future. We believe that what we do today has a drastic impact on tomorrow. Matthew 25, verse 23 says, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. Jesus was telling a parable in this moment. And he said, the moral of the story, as he summed up the whole parable, was simply this, right? You did a great job of being generous. You did a great job of leveraging what you had for all it was worth to make a difference. You did a great job of thinking about the future, not just today. I'm going to leave you with three things today that I want you to be thinking about. On your seat, there's a card. And it says Future Hope, and then it has three headings: World Compassion, Church Multiplication, and Next Generation. These are three areas that we're going to focus on this next year and in the coming years. World Compassion. We believe that God has given us a significant opportunity to bring the gospel to the Middle East. Before the pandemic hit, you guys remember I got to go to Turkey and we got to help plant churches there. Those churches are beginning to take off and thrive. We've been raising money and sending that off and partnering with that. There's an underground radio network where the gospel is being preached called Shema Radio, where we've been financing and helping support that along with other churches all across Southern California that have been partnering with that, and then helping with the refugee project where they're setting up these training schools and they're cloaked like coffee shops and like sewing classes where refugees can come and learn a trade and learn the language and then actually become active members of society, all the whole while learning about the love of Jesus. Like when you're learning to speak English at the coffee shop, you're learning through a biblical curriculum to how to speak English. And the reason they're teaching them English and Turkish is because the refugees that are coming into Turkey that only speak Arabic are being relegated to, oh, you're just a refugee, so we're not going to hire you. You don't even speak Turkish. You don't even speak English. How are we going to give you a job? And so these Christian coffee shops, now they're just coffee shops, right? Our strategic partners. We've just been given an opportunity, Jennifer and I, to go this March to Egypt to help plant a few hundred churches over the course of the next few years and to bring clean water to the rural areas outside of Cairo. Jennifer and I are going to go this March and investigate and find out what's happening and partner with about 400 other churches here in Southern California that are going to be a part of that as well. And here's the deal, right? We believe, and right now God's opening the door in the Middle East for us to come and to plant these churches. It's crazy in Turkey. The biggest church planting movement in Turkey is actually coming out of Korea. The Christians in South Korea made it to Turkey and they're planting churches. And so we're just like, look, we don't need to come over there and plant new churches. Let's just finance the Korean churches. It's crazy though, because I met an Afghanistan refugee in Turkey who spoke English with a Korean accent. Because it was the Korean Christians who taught him English. And that Afghan refugee is now translating the Bible into children's books. Bible stories into children's books. And like, this is the deal, right? These powerful moments that are happening because we believe at Hope City Church to bring hope to the world one person at a time. We believe that every person should have access to the gospel. We're hoping this year to go back down into Mexico and do a house build together. We were able to help financially with the house build last year and send a little bit of money, but we're hoping this year to actually go and to help financially and physically go down and to do a three-day build with Amore and build a house again or more than one house again if we can. And then we're partnering with Convoy of Hope to be sort of our hands and feet on the ground every time there's a disaster in the world, every time there's a hurricane, a tsunami, a tornado, a fire, a whatever, Convoy of Hope, they go and they bring the needs. And so by financially supporting them and partnering with them, we're going to be able to bring disaster relief every time there's a disaster. Instead of us trying to find someone to partner with, we trust Convoy. We know Convoy. Aaron and I personally know a lot of the people that work there, and we're going to be able to partner with them and bring disaster relief all around the world whenever something happens. Not just here, but literally like when the fires were happening in Northern California, Convoy of Hope was there. A couple of years ago when the earthquake was in Haiti or the bombing in Beirut or whenever, the fireworks explosion in Beirut, all that stuff that happened, right? Convoy was there. And so you not only are going to meet the needs of people right where they are physically when disasters happen, but humanitarian needs, with people who can't hear about Jesus until their stomachs are fed and their hearts are healed, but also planting churches everywhere that we have an opportunity to do that. Because we believe to bring hope to the world, you need to bring the local church to those communities. That's why church multiplication is so important to us. Not just multiplying churches right here in the United States, but churches all around the world. And so we're going to commit ourselves to do that. But it's not enough to just help plant churches in these spaces and places that God's entrusted to us. We want to challenge you to be thinking, because the world is now changed. Here at home, the world has changed. And so what does it look like for you to be prayerful about? What is a microsite? Church in your backyard, church at your barbershop, church at your coffee shop or at your warehouse look like? Because you have friends and neighbors and loved ones that would never maybe come to this building, but they would come to your shop and have church on a Thursday night with you. What would it look like to have Hope at Home be a normal thing that is a part of what we do here as well? What would it look like for us to be dreaming about the future and potentially launching new campuses? We had some organic Hope at Home things happen during the pandemic. We had a group that launched a church service in the Philippines, one in India. And the one in the Philippines was crazy. They're like, hey, our pastor's got COVID. Can we just play your pastor's sermons? And then they broke up. They weren't allowed to meet in church. So they just like all started their little home groups and were like playing Hope City in the Philippines. We don't have the technology to do it, but we can like stream it on the internet in our houses. And I got to thinking, and Aaron and I were praying, and we were all talking about it as a staff. Why does this have to be some special thing? Why can't we just normalize that? As people in San Diego who are very transitory move away, whether it's their military or whether it's expensive or I want to go to Texas or Ohio or all the places and spaces that people go, why can't we take Hope City all over the world? Church multiplication, I think, is powerful. But church multiplication doesn't have to be in a building that looks like this, because we, what? Come on. And so where you go, the church goes. The fullness of the Holy Spirit dwells in you. And so we can resource those families and those people who want to launch these microsites and these church locations and really get back to the heart of the online community being something that God called us to at the very beginning of all of this. We're going to still do in-person services, but we believe that God's calling us to reach a generation who screen their natives with their screens and still have the ability to be connective and authentic and serve and generous. Lastly, next generation, we believe with all of our hearts that this isn't just our church, but this is the church for our kids and our grandkids and our great-great-grandkids. That we want to build something here that will last for generations to come. But to do that, we have to develop the leaders that God's entrusted to us. And we'll do that with lots of ways. We have discipleship and camps and retreats for our next generation kids. And when we say next generation, you're going to hear that a lot more. We're talking zero to college. We're talking about developing people into the men and women of God that He's called them to be. We're talking about giving people opportunities to be ministers in their communities. And so what does that look like? That might look like they're marketplace ministers. We talk about this all the time, right? Where you're the pastor of your ship. You're the pastor of your work group. You're the pastor of your four cubicles that are right around you. You're the pastor of your neighborhood, of your coffee shop, of your bar. I can't be that pastor, but you can. But you need the tools available to you to do that. But we don't have to wait till someone's 25 to equip them to do the work of ministry. That we can start at a very young age to build into them this lifestyle of generosity where life change actually happens. And so I really would love for you to take this card and to keep it somewhere nearby. If you want more than one of them, grab one off one of the empty chairs, put one in your car, one in your Bible, one on your fridge. And I want you to see these ideals as something that you'd be constantly praying for, because this is the future and this is what we're praying for. But we're going to have to lay foundations in order to build this future on. Do me a favor and stand where you are right now.